In 1944, the Mosquito was equipped with an outrageous new heavy weapon. They called it the U-Boat Buster. Des Curtis was a crew member on one of the first Mosquitoes to be fitted out with this beast.
Des, this is a heck of a bit of kit, isn't it?
It is a massive piece of equipment. The Mosquito, equipped with a weapon like this, could get in very quickly, right up to the U-boat pens, attack the U-boats when they thought they were safely home, and get out again.
Just amazing.
This was the weapon. Now, if you look at a shell of that size and compare it with a 20mm cannon shell, this was the size of a shell that, say, a Spitfire would fire. By comparison, this was the 57mm.
It's an artillery piece. It goes from a machine gun to an actual real cannon, doesn't it, really?
Because it started its life as an anti-tank gun. Fantastic power.
You must have been anxious when it came to firing the trigger for the first time and thinking this gun's going to rip the bottom end of our aeroplane off.
Well, that anxiety was quickly dismissed because what you got, in fact, was a massive bang. The aircraft seemed to shudder to a halt, but for a macro second, and it was said that all the instruments went back to zero. But the extraordinary thing was, there was never an instance where the mounting of this massive gun on a wooden spar, where that mounting became slightly dislodged.
That's just testament to the aircraft itself.
I suppose everybody who flew Mosquitoes had total faith in that aircraft.
Armed with this giant cannon, Des Curtis and his pilot would become the first ever Mozzie crew to sink a U-boat. And Des's story was later immortalised in one of the classic works of military literature, The Victor. Late in 1943, Mosquitoes were equipped with a six-pounder cannon.
I wonder if the airframe will stand up to your cannon, Bill. It'll take it all right. The Mozzie is a great plane.
Then, on March 25th, 1944...
You'll meet up with your fighter escort, then proceed to your patrol area off the west coast of France.
Well, we're now in our patrol area, but there's not much happening.
Suddenly...
Flak, let's get out of here.
Turner and Curtis took their plane down low.
Look, beyond the minesweeper, a surfaced U-boat. We'll get nearer.
And then we'll give them a taste of our six-pounder.
As soon as they had the U-boat in their sights, the Mosquito opened up.
We've got her. She's sinking.
Low-level raider, bomber, fighter, and U-boat buster. That's what I love about the Mozzie. This really was an aircraft that could do anything you asked of it. And it wasn't finished yet. Late in the war, RAF chiefs decided the Mosquito could be used to help finish off the Japanese in the Pacific. But to do that, it would have to take off and land from an aircraft carrier. The Navy's top test pilot was called in.
I was suddenly asked by the Admiralty if I felt I could land a Mosquito on an aircraft carrier. Now, we had never landed an aircraft of this weight, or nor had anybody else on an aircraft carrier. The Boffins associated with it, I knew, they didn't say this in front of me, but I heard it from many sources, they were calling it Mission Impossible.
This dangerous manoeuvre had been tried before using other aircraft, with disastrous results. Landing a Mosquito on a carrier was an even more risky operation because of its sheer speed.
Now, the stalling speed of the Mosquito is 110 miles an hour. By stalling speed, I mean at that speed, it will fall out of the sky. I was told the maximum speed I could land on was 84 miles an hour. So, if an engine as much as coughed on the approach, you've got a real problem. The aircraft would have just rotated upside down.
On the 25th of March 1944, Eric safely landed his 7-ton Mosquito on a carrier in the Irish Sea. Not once, but 5 times.
It was a real masterpiece of design. I'm often asked, what saved Britain? What type of aircraft saved Britain? And my answer is, the Mosquito was particularly important because it just wasn't a fighter or a bomber. It was a night fighter, a reconnaissance aircraft, ground attack aircraft. It was a multi-purpose aircraft.
The Mosquito was without doubt the most versatile combat aircraft of the war. And if proof was still needed of its powers, that arrived in 1944, when the Mozzie was called on to undertake its toughest mission yet. At Amiens prison in France, the Nazis were holding 700 members of the French resistance, and they'd begun making mass executions. The only way to save them involved terrible risks. Destroy the prison walls without inflicting huge casualties.
It was snowing hard as the aircraft flew out from England at Nordfeet across the sea towards the French coast. They were picked up by their fighter escort of 2 Typhoons to each aircraft. So bad was the visibility that they had to fly almost wingtip to wingtip.
This unique footage captures the moment when 9 Mosquitoes zeroed in on the prison. With amazing accuracy, they smashed the perimeter wall, freeing more than 250 resistance fighters.
There was absolutely nothing to beat the Mosquito. Here was this magnificent thing which would come zooming in. So if you want to knock down a prison holding a lot of resistance people in France, you send the Mosquitoes, because they can hit this with staggering precision. It's absolutely astounding.
The breach walls were 20 feet high. Through the gaps, friends of the Allies made good their escape in this, one of the most difficult operations of the war.
For me, it was the sheer audacity of raids like this one that turned the Mosquito into a legend. And it's a legend that deserves to be remembered. But that's hard without a single airworthy example in the world. Now, that's all about to change. For the past 8 years, a team of enthusiasts has been working to bring the world's only flying Mosquito back to life. And I'm hoping to become the first Brit to fly in it. To find the world's only flying Mosquito, I've come to Virginia Beach in America. Millionaire Jerry Yagan has put together one of the world's largest collections of World War II aeroplanes. For an aircraft nut like me, his annual show is a little slice of heaven on earth. Shame no one told me about the fancy dress. Wow, Focke Wulf 190. Incredibly aggressive looking machine and one of the Mosquito's biggest adversaries. The Harvard. Many Mosquito pilots would have earned their wings on this aircraft.
What airplane do you fly? I don't want to even ask you this.
I fly the best airplane Britain ever made, the Spitfire.
Wrong.
But the star attraction of this year's show isn't a Spitfire, and it isn't a Lancaster. It's the aircraft that I've been dreaming about since I was a kid. For nearly 20 years, there hasn't been a single Mosquito flying anywhere in the world. Now, after 8 years of painstaking labour, an original World War II Mozzie has been brought back to life.
When perfection comes together, that is what you experience. She just looks like she wants to go up. What a legend. What a flipping legend.
By late 1944, the Mosquito had helped the Allies notch up success after success. But when victory finally came in 1945, the Mosquito's greatest strength turned out to be a weakness. Unlike metal aircraft, the Mosquito's wooden frame made it vulnerable to decay. Most of them simply rotted away. And in the years that followed, it was quickly forgotten. But now, the Mosquito is ready to fly again, thanks to the efforts of American warbird fanatic Jerry Yeagan.
So, Jerry, we're here to talk about your new toy. What is it you personally love the most about the Mosquito? What parts of it?
I like the rarity of it, that right now it's the only one flying, and that makes it very unusual.
Well, you're the man that did it the first time, and I take my hat off to you as well. It's an incredible thing. What was the final figure that you paid for the Mosquito?
Too much. But the airplane is priceless.
Yeah.
And I don't think they looked this good when they came out of the factory during the war.
No. We've got none flying on the UK circuit. Are you surprised that we don't have any on our air show circuit?
Very much so. I don't think that's going to last forever. I think somebody's going to build a Mosquito. And some Brit is going to build a Mosquito.
Yeah, I am. on that note, Jerry, do you think, therefore, that it's a right that we should take this aeroplane back to the UK with us when we leave on Monday?
Well, interesting.
Yeah. So how much fuel do you think we'd need to do that flight? With KA-114 fully fueled up, we could get off the runway here and back to the UK, OK?
Well, you'd have to stop somewhere along the way. Plus, you got to go through customs.
OK, so I failed to persuade Jerry to hand over the keys to his Mosquito. But my real goal was to be on board for its first ever public flight in the US. But things weren't that simple. Jerry's Mosquito had only been given official clearance to fly 2 days before my arrival. And due to health and safety concerns over my disability, it seemed unlikely I was going to be allowed to go up. But the Royal Marines never say die.
The guys have just told me we've only saw the Mosquito for the first time today, and they've told me that we're going up in it right now because Mike, the pilot, Mike Spaulding, out of the blue, just said, I want to take it up for a test. And he said, we need somebody to go with him. And the guy said, I think you should go. A little bit in awe right now, I don't really know what to say.
But while I was still feeling shell-shocked, a veteran Mosquito pilot had some words of warning for today's pilot, Mike Spaulding.
It sits here in an elegant, ballerina-like, smug, beautiful pose. The most beautiful airplane in the world, daring anybody to fly her. And she would go racing into the air and roll, wing overs, and swoop, and just everything. And the dark side is, at the hands of somebody who's afraid of her, who under controls or afraid to push the throttles, you know, she is a mean bitch whose only aim is to kill both of them as fast and as horribly as she can.
As George explained, this otherwise perfect machine had one potentially fatal flaw. The Mosquito's light plywood frame and its frightening acceleration made it prone to veering violently off the runway during takeoff. During the war, many inexperienced crews died just trying to get it into the air. And even once airborne, there were other dangers in wait. Mike wanted to review the footage of the last time a Mosquito flew 17 years ago, and it ended in tragedy. This time, for a completely different reason.
Kind of stalled there, he's lost it, now it's just falling.
Get it back under control.
What happened was when he went in, inverted and did zero or negative G, his engine actually quit. One of the Achilles heel for the Mosquito was the carburetor, float carburetors, that whenever they did any evasive maneuvers, the engines would quit.
What they suffered from there, we don't have an issue with here, but we still do.
If we were to do that and go make a positive G, like push it over that way, that they would quit. We don't do anything like that in here, so we should never have an issue like that.
I hope so.
But what
does she glide like if we lost the engines?
Like a brick with wings.
The Mosquito may be my dream aircraft, but finding out about its dark side was starting to give me a few jitters.
Looking at the footage of how helplessly that thing fell out of the air at the hands of two extremely experienced pilots with many hours of Mosquito flying under their belt, they couldn't do anything about it. Now, Mike's only got 6 hours on this type of aircraft. It's a little concerning. You know, he's an incredibly competent pilot and he's flown other twin aircraft, but if he gets it wrong, it's really, really going to bite him and me on the ass.
With pre-flight checks complete, it was time to put the Mosquito to the test. After years of reading and dreaming about this aircraft, I'm going to find out for myself why the Mosquito was so special.
Start on number two. Here we go. Does not get any better than this. Release the brakes. My God. And we're airborne. We're up. Woo. We are airborne. Christ, the power! You won't get it with a Spitfire. You won't get it, even get it with a Lancaster. This is just insane. I've spent a lifetime dreaming about this moment, but nothing quite prepares you for the real thing. This is just out of this world. In the process of making this film, I've met the guys who built and flew the Mozzie, and I've heard some amazing stories about what they achieved. But it's only now that I can really feel why those guys love this aircraft above all others.
The Wellington was solid, stayed. This one was exciting. It was just lovely. If it had been any other airplane, I wouldn't be here. No, definitely.
Hands on the controls. Oh my God. I am flying a loop
over Virginia Beach Airport in the Mosquito.
It's got the range, the height, the speed. It can do anything. And in that sense, I think some of us, including me, would argue this was a more remarkable design achievement than the Spitfire.
Mate, you have not lived until you do that shit.
That's just the most thrilling adrenaline junkie ride you will ever experience in your life.
Legend, legend. Oh, man. You've got to get one of these in the UK. There's no question about it. No question about it.
When I set out to make this film, I was already a fully signed up member of the Mosquito fan club. But having met the guys who flew it and actually taken the controls myself, I'm even more in awe of this beautiful machine. It seems kind of ironic, actually, that the whole journey that started me off in my flying career was the worst day of my life, which was the car crash that put me in this wheelchair. And now, 6 years down the line, we're here, and I'm experiencing, by a long way, the best day of my life. It just feels like two bookends. We've had the worst, and now we've had the best. And where do you go from there? Today, there may be only one in the world left flying. But in a strange way, the Mozzie never went away. Because it was the Mosquito's success as both bomber and fighter which pointed the way to our own age of twin-engined, multi-purpose combat jets. The Tornadoes and Typhoons that fight our wars for us today all owe a debt of gratitude to the breakthrough achieved by one man in a hangar in Hertfordshire more than 70 years ago.